أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين بارئ الخلائق أجمعين باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين ثم الصلاة والسلام على خير خلقه العبد المؤيد والرسول المسدد حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد
اللهم صل على
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وصحابته المنتجبين صلى الله عليك يا رسول الله صلى الله عليك يا سيدي ويا مولاي يا رحمة الله الواسعة ويا باب نجاة الأمة ويا عبرة يا مظلوم يا غريب يا شهيد كربلاء يا ليتنا يا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ثاني اثنين إذ هما في الغار إذ يقول لصاحبه لا تحزن لا تحزن إن الله معنا فأنزل الله سكينته عليه وأيده بجنود لم تروها صلوا على محمد وآل محمد
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
A second for the love of Imams al-Hasan wal-Hussein
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
A third for the love of Fatima al-Zahra with your loudest voices
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
He is regarded by Sunni Muslims as the first rightly guided Khalifa, the closest companion to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, the most pious and the most righteous and the most knowledgeable person after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, the greatest of the Sahaba. As for Shia Muslims, he is regarded as the first usurper in Islam, the first to violate the rights of the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the first man to create a division amongst the Muslims, the first person to create a fitna in this ummah, this controversial figure that all Muslims have disagreed upon, Sunni and Shia Muslims, is none other than Abu Bakr Abdullah ibn Abi Quhafa. the companion of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, and the father-in-law of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. In March of 2013, I gave a lecture in the United Kingdom under the title of A Biography of Umar ibn al-Khattab. And that lecture required a sequel. And tonight comes the sequel, The Biography of Abu Bakr. We will, to the best of our ability, as the tradition with our previous lectures, we will remain unbiased and objective. And whatever we mention tonight on the life of Abu Bakr, on his life stories from cradle to grave, an analysis of the stages of his life before Islam, after Islam, before the death of Rasulullah, and after the death of Rasulullah, when he became the apparent Khalifa. As we give this analysis, we will stick to Sunni sources and only Sunni sources. Nothing that we will mention tonight regarding the life of Abu Bakr will be from Shia sources. Of course, if we wanted to mention Shia sources, it will be a different sort of discussion. And the discussion will be a lot longer. Tonight, we will only stick to the Sunni sources and what Sunni authors had to say about Abu Bakr. I ask my brothers and sisters, my dear viewers, my dear listeners, to keep an open mind, an open heart, with attentive tears, and with attentive ears, hopefully no tears. And as the Quran says, الَّذِينَ يَسْتَمِعُونَ الْقَوْلَ فَيَتَّبِعُونَ أَحْسَنَ. Believers, they listen. They listen to what others have to say, and then they choose the best. Thus, hopefully our dear brothers and sisters will keep an open mind and an open heart, and we will, as we promise, to remain as objective and unbiased as possible. If credit is due, we will give credit when credit is due, and we will show the truth based upon Sunni sources and authors only. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us in this aim and objective with the blessings of Allah and salawat for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
His name, his birth, his lineage, and his titles. Abu Bakr, his name is Abdullah ibn Abi Quhafa. His name is Abdullah, one of the names that historians, the most famous name that historians have mentioned him is Abdullah. Other names that have been mentioned is Atiq, Abdul Ka'ba. These are some of the names that have been ascribed to Abu Bakr. But yet his most famous name, according to historians, is Abdullah ibn Abi Quhafa. His father, Abu Quhafa, that's his title. His name is Uthman ibn Amir. His mother, Abu Bakr's mother, as some historians mention, is Salma bint Sakhr ibn Amir. This name has been given for his mother. There's another name that has been mentioned. Salma bint Sakhr ibn Amir would be Abu Quhafa's cousin. That means if Salma is his mother, that means his parents were cousins. However, there's another name mentioned for his mother, and that is Layla. According to some historians, namely Ibn al-Athir in Ustul Ghaba. This is not from a Shi'i source. I repeat, this is not from a Shi'i source. This is from a well-known Sunni source, Ustul Ghaba, fi Ma'rifat al-Sahaba, by Ibn al-Athir. He says that if Layla is his mother, the mother of Abu Bakr, Layla was the niece of Abu Quhafa, was the niece of his father, not his cousin, but his niece. This is according to Usdul Ghaba. For those that don't take my word for it, in fact, I tell my listeners, don't take my word for it. I urge you, either as you're listening to me, or when you go back home, or when you listen to this lecture online, Google the information that I say. And hopefully you will find that what we are saying is accurate according to the Sunni books and sources. His birth. Abu Bakr was born 3 years after Aam al-Fil, the year of the elephant. That makes him 3 years younger than whom? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because Rasulullah was born in the year of the elephant, Aam al-Fil. Abu Bakr was born 3 years after. Approximately 573 AD. His nickname is Abu Bakr. His name is Abdullah ibn Abi Quhafa. His nickname, his kunya, is Abu Bakr. His title, historically, has been called As-Siddiq. Abu Bakr As-Siddiq. Why is he called As-Siddiq? Well, what does As-Siddiq mean? The one who believes. The one who trusts and believes. Why was he called this? According to Ibn al-Athir in Usd al-Ghaba, he narrates from Aisha that when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam came back from al-Isra wal-Mi'raj, from the night journey, none of his Sahaba were with him. He came and he told the story to his Sahaba. The first to believe him, according to this narration, is Abu Bakr. He believed Rasulullah regarding his night journey, even though he did not witness it. Hence, Rasulullah called him As-Siddiq, the believer, the one who believes, the one who trusts. However, when we read Kitab Al-Isaba fi Ma'rifat Al-Sahaba by the famous Sunni, staunch Sunni author Ibn Hajar Al-Asqalani, he tells us that this title, As-Siddiq, belonged to someone else. Not Abu Bakr. This is a Sunni source. He narrates from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, that Rasulullah stated that after me, satakun min ba'di fitna. I will translate it into English because we have a lot of content to cover tonight. Thus, I will only translate it to English. That after me, there will be a great fitna. And I urge you to hold on to Ali ibn Abi Talib. فَإِذَا كَانَ ذَلِكَ فَأَلْزِمُوا عَلِيَّ بْنَ أَبِي طَالِبٍ. Why? Because he was the first to believe in me, and he will be the first to shake my hand on the Day of Judgment. وَهُوَ الصَّدِّيقُ الْأَكْبَرُ وَهُوَ فَارُوقُ هَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ. From this hadith, we know that the titles of As-Siddiq, who does it really belong to? And the title of Al-Faruq, who's given to someone else, who does it really belong to? وَهُوَ يَعْسُوبُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. This is in Kitab al-Asaba, fi Ma'rifat al-Sahaba, by Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, a Sunni to the bone. He mentions this hadith, that the title As-Siddiq belongs to Ali ibn Abi Talib. The first to convert. This is one of the qualities that has been mentioned about Abu Bakr. Ibn Abd al-Barr, in his famous book, Al-Isti'ab fi Ma'rifat al-Ashab, mentions that Abu Bakr was the first man to convert to Islam and the first man to pray behind Rasulullah. This is what Ibn Abd al-Barr mentions in Al-Isti'ab. Why does he say the first man? Because there was someone else before him. That was Ali ibn Abi Talib. And there was someone else as well, Khadija alayhi salam. But because they need to give him a virtue, he has to be the first something. He can't be the first to convert because everyone agrees the first to convert was Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib. No one questions that, Sunni and Shia. And everyone agrees that Khadija also beat Abu Bakr to the conversion to Islam. So he needs a virtue. What is that virtue? The first man to convert to Islam. The first male adult to convert to Islam. Okay. However, we see that there are some Sunni historians. I'm not talking about Shia. Tonight, let's put the Shia aside. Tonight, we have nothing to do with Shia historians or Shia scholars. Let's put them aside. Some Sunni historians contest this view that Abu Bakr was the first man to convert to Islam. There are some Sunni historians that say he was not the first, he was not the second, he was not the third, he was not even the tenth. According to al-Tabari, the famous historian, Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, al-Tabari states that Abu Bakr was the 50th, 50, to convert to Islam. 50th. You have an issue with this? Take it out on al-Tabari. Don't take it out on Shia. This al-Tabari was not a Shi'i. He was not a Shi'i scholar. In fact, he was the imam of a Sunni madhab, of a Sunni school of thought. Just like Abu Hanifa, al-Malik, Shafi'i, Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Al-Tabari had his own fiqhi school of thought. This is his opinion. That Abu Bakr was the 50th person to convert. Also, Al-Tabari and Ibn Majah, the famous Ibn Majah, they narrate that Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib had stated, صَلَّيْتُ قَبْلَ النَّاسِ بِسَبْعِ سِنِينَ, that I prayed before everyone else, of course except Rasulullah and Khadija, I prayed before everyone else 7 years, before others. 7 years before others prayed, I prayed. 7 years, that's a long time. Where was Abu Bakr within these 7 years? When did he convert? When did he come and pray? Ibn Abd al-Barr claims that Abu Bakr was the first to pray. Imam Ali alayhi salam says, I prayed before others by 7 years. This is Ibn Majah and al-Tabari. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Now, our Sunni brothers and sisters, when they speak of Abu Bakr, the first quality, the first merit, the first virtue that they mention about him is that he was with Rasulullah in where? The cave. He was the companion of Rasulullah in the cave. Now, let's say that indeed it was Abu Bakr, because there are some Shi'i historians that say it was a man by the name of Abu Bakr, but it was not Abdullah ibn Abi Quhafa, it was someone else. But let's put this aside. Let's, for argument's sake, accept that it was Abu Bakr Abdullah ibn Abi Quhafa in the cave with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Let's take this and let's, you know, agree. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his life was in danger. He was about to be assassinated the last night that he was in Mecca. Hence he left. And who slept in his place? Ali ibn Abi Talib slept in his bed, and he left. When he left, he met Abu Bakr, and they walked together, and they headed towards a mountain, Jabal al-Thawr, and they went into a cave, because the mushrikeen, they came behind them, behind Rasulullah, they wanted to kill Rasulullah. They went into the cave. Everyone knows the famous story of the cave, and how the cave was covered with a spider's web, and so on and so forth. They remained in the cave for 3 days. We all accept this. Allah reveals a verse regarding the story. إِلَّا تَنْصُرُوهُ فَقَدْ نَصَرَهُ اللَّهُ. If you don't support him, Allah speaks to the mushrikeen of Mecca. If you do not support him, we supported him. إِذْ أَخْرَجَهُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا ثَانِيَ اثْنَيْنِ. Rasulullah was one of two. ثَانِيَ اثْنَيْنِ إِذْ هُمَا فِي الْغَارِ إِذْ يَقُولُ لِصَاحِبِهِ لَا تَحْزَنْ. Rasulullah was one of two. Who was the second? Abu Bakr. Rasulullah and Abu Bakr. They were in the cave. إِذْ يَقُولُ لِصَاحِبِهِ. The Prophet tells his companion, do not be sad. They say, see? Allah says in the Holy Quran that Abu Bakr is the companion of Rasulullah. Which other companion has this merit? Which other companion of Rasulullah has this virtue that Allah testifies that he's a companion of Rasulullah? إِذْ يَقُولُ لِصَاحِبِهِ. The Prophet tells his companion, do not be sad. لَا تَحْزَن. Allah is with us. إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَنَا. Allah is with us. That means Allah is with the Prophet and with Abu Bakr. And Allah and the Prophet is showing compassion to Abu Bakr by telling him, do not be sad. That means the Prophet cares for him. Otherwise, why would he tell him, do not be sad? فَأَنزَلَ اللَّهُ سَكِينَتُهُ عَلَيْهِ. Allah brought down calmness and peace upon whom? عَلَيْهِ. Upon the one that was sad. Meaning whom? Abu Bakr. Allah brought down peace and tranquility upon Abu Bakr. Does it get better than this? Bunch of merits. So one, he's the companion of Rasulullah. إِذْ يَقُولُ لِصَاحِبِهِ. The Quran testifies. Two, the Prophet sympathizes with him. He shows him sympathy, shows him compassion. لَا تَحْزَن. Number three, Allah is with him. إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَنَا. The Prophet tells him that Allah is with us. And number four, فَأَنزَلَ اللَّهُ سَكِينَتُهُ عَلَيْهِ. Allah reveals his, brings down his peace and tranquility upon Abu Bakr. Now this is what our Sunni brothers and sisters say when speaking about the virtues and merits of Abu Bakr. Now they answer, yes. إِذْ يَقُولُ لِصَاحِبِهِ. The Prophet tells his companion, the Quran calls Abu Bakr his companion, صَاحِبِهِ. But what does صَاحِب actually mean? The word صَاحِب has been mentioned in the Quran numerous times. And it, when it is used in the Quran, it is used as mate. Someone's mate. Mate. When you have a mate. إِذْ يَقُولُ لِصَاحِبِهِ. Abu Bakr is the Prophet's mate. Is this a virtue? Not necessarily. Because in the Quran, صَاحِب has been used many times in the meaning of mate and not necessarily in a positive sense. And not necessarily in a negative sense. For example, the Quran tells us about Yusuf, Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam, when he was in jail, when he was in prison, there were people in prison with him that were mushrikeen, that did not even believe in Allah. Prophet Yusuf was speaking to them. What does he call them? Ya sahibay al-sijn. يا صاحبي السجن أرباب متفرقون خير أم الله الواحد القهار. He calls them my mates, and they were polytheists, they were mushrikeen. So just by saying إذ يقول لصاحبه, he's talking to his mate. It doesn't entail anything. It doesn't prove that he's a believer. It doesn't prove that he's a mushrik either. It's just that he's his mate. It has absolutely no virtue. In another verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us of two people, a believer and a non-believer, having a discourse, having a dialogue. The believer, فَإِنْ قَالَ لَهُ صَاحِبُهُ وَهُوَ يُحَاوِرُهُ أَكَفَرْتَ بِالَّذِي خَلَقَكَ مِنْ تُرَابٍ ثُمَّ مِنْ نُطْفَةٍ ثُمَّ سَوَاكَ رَجُلًا. The believer speaks to the non-believer. The Quran says he speaks to his mate, the صاحبه. قال له صاحبه. One of them is a believer and his mate is a non-believer. Does that have any a virtue? Just being a sahib have any virtue? Doesn't prove anything. Doesn't prove anything. Doesn't prove any merit or virtue. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about the people of Mecca who are polytheists, who are non-believers. He tells them that your mate, صاحب, ما ضل صاحبكم وما غوى, that your mate, your sahib, meaning Rasulullah, did not go astray. ما ضل صاحبكم. Your mate, even though they are mushrikeen and he's a believer, Rasulullah is a mu'min, and they are mushrikeen, but they're mates. So the Quran tells us that two mates, one could be a believer, one could be a mushrik. Doesn't necessarily mean that the two mates have to be both believers or both on the same level. I'm not trying to say that Abu Bakr is a disbeliever. I'm not trying to say this. But does it necessarily mean that he has virtue or merits just from this word? إِذْ يَقُولُ لِصَاحِبِهِ. No. This is from the Quran. I'm not mentioning any hadith. From the Quran. This is one. Two. إِذْ يَقُولُ لِصَاحِبِهِ لَا تَحْزَن. They say Rasulullah is showing compassion to Abu Bakr. That means he has to be of good stage, on a good level. That Rasulullah is showing him compassion. He's telling him, do not be sad. Well, question. Being sad, was it a virtue or was it a vice? If it's a virtue, why is Rasulullah telling him, don't be sad? If it's a virtue, he should be sad. Rasulullah is telling him, La tahzan, do not be sad. So it can be a virtue. If it's a virtue, Rasulullah would not forbid him from holding that virtue. Hence it must be a vice. Thus the verse works against them. The verse not only does not show virtue, perhaps it shows vice. And why would Abu Bakr have sadness? They say he was sad for Rasulullah because he was afraid that they will attack and Rasulullah will be killed. They say there was no one else. It was only the Prophet Abu Bakr. How do you know that he was sad for Rasulullah? Were you inside his heart to know that he was sad or he had fear for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? There was no one else there. Let's be objective. How do you know that he was sad for Rasulullah? How do you know that he was not sad for himself? He was afraid of being killed. And that's natural. You know, no one would blame him for being scared. Because he was about to be attacked by the mushrikeen. Rasulullah is telling him, "La tahzan," do not be sad. How is this a virtue? How is this a virtue, if not a vice? "Inna Allah ma'ana," Allah is with us. They say this is a virtue. Because Rasulullah is telling him that Allah is with us, Allah is with me and with you. Hence, Allah is with Abu Bakr. So this is a virtue. Allah is with us, yes. Inna Allah ma'ana, in this duo. Because who's in this duo? Rasulullah is in this duo. Rasulullah is in this a group of two. Hence, Allah is with them. Take Rasulullah out of this group. What do you have? Inna Allah ma'ana, because Rasulullah is there. This is one possibility. Another possibility is Rasulullah speaking of himself. Inna Allah ma'ana, he's actually saying, Inna Allah ma'i, Allah is with me. But Rasulullah is speaking in plural sense, in plural terms. And this is not new. A lot of times Rasulullah would speak in plural, he would not speak in singular. Allah speaks in plural, sometimes not in singular. Inna nahnu nazzalna al-dhikra wa inna lahu al-hamd. We have revealed the remembrance. So Rasulullah could be speaking in plural, not in singular. This doesn't prove anything. This doesn't prove any sort of virtue for Abu Bakr. And Allah brought down His calmness and tranquility. فَأَنزَلَ اللَّهُ سَكِينَتَهُ عَلَيْهِ. Upon whom? Allah revealed His serenity and peace and tranquility upon whom? Let's read the continuation of the verse. وَأَيَّدَهُ بِجُنُودٍ لَمْ تَرَوْهَا. And He supported him with troops that you could not see, meaning with angels. Who did Allah support? Rasulullah. If the second part of the verse is talking about Rasulullah, so the first part of the verse should be talking about whom? Rasulullah as well. Why did they switch things around and say that it was revealed about Abu Bakr? The verse is very clear that it's talking about Rasulullah. فَأَنزَلَ اللَّهُ سَكِينَتُهُ عَلَيْهِ وَأَيَّدَهُ بِجُنُودٍ لَمْ تَرَوْهُ. He brought down his peace and tranquility upon him and he supported him with troops that you did not see. Obviously the verse is talking about Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wa sallam. You might say, but, and this is what they say, but Rasulullah was not scared. So why would Allah bring down his peace and tranquility upon him? The answer is he doesn't need to be scared. Allah brings his peace and blessings and tranquility and calmness upon Rasulullah at all times. He doesn't need to be scared. And another verse where Rasulullah was not scared, Allah brought down his peace and tranquility. أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ سَكِينَتَهُ عَلَىٰ رَسُولِهِ وَعَلَىٰ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَأَنزَلَ جُنُودًا لَمْ تَرَوْهَا. This is another verse. Allah brought down his peace and tranquility upon the Prophet. He doesn't need to be scared. So where's the virtue? Where's the merit in this verse? This is, if we want to stop here, we could go further to prove that it's not just a virtue. Not only it's not a virtue, but it could be used as a vice. But I don't want to, let's press some brakes here. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Historians mention that Abu Bakr came and proposed to Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salam. He came and proposed, so did Umar. And they were both denied, they were both rejected. And Rasulullah gave them an excuse. What was the excuse? إنها صغيرة, she's too young. Al-Hakim al-Naysaburi in his Al-Mustadrak ala al-Sahihain, he mentions this. That Abu Bakr proposed to Rasulullah for his daughter, Fatima, he was denied. While Imam Ali alayhi salam proposed to Fatima al-Zahra, he was accepted. He was not denied. And this is in Sunni traditions and sources. His courage in battle. When we study the life of Abu Bakr, we know that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi fought over 80 battles. Over 80 battles. There were many that were killed. Many were wounded. And there were some from the side of Rasulullah that were also killed. They were also wounded. And there were some that killed others. Like Imam Ali alayhi salam. Imam Ali, there's a whole list of the mushrikeen and the evildoers that he killed. Now when we read history books from Sunni and Shia sources, but I'm talking about Sunni sources, I wanted to find a single name, a single person that was killed at the hands of Abu Bakr in the battles of Rasulullah. I did not find a single name. No one was killed at the hands of Abu Bakr. No one. And I challenge anyone to come and mention one name, one person that was killed at the hands of Abu Bakr. Not a single name. In Sunni sources, not a single name. No one was killed. Where was he in the battles? Where was he in the battles? Was he in the forefront? Was he in the offensive? Was he in the defensive? Where was he in the battles? He was not seen in the battles. Now, of course, this is quite embarrassing. When Sunni scholars, they see this, they have to find a merit, some sort of courage for Abu Bakr. So they thought of something. And they mention in their books that Abu Bakr was in the Arish. What was the Arish? He was protecting the tent of Rasulullah. He was not in the battle, but he was standing along with others carrying a weapon, protecting the tent of Rasulullah. And they say this is courageous. Because the tent of Rasulullah, it could have been under attack. The mushrikeen could have attacked Rasulullah at any minute. And Abu Bakr was showing courage, was showing bravery by protecting the tent of Rasulullah. Now I ask you, when you have Ali ibn Abi Talib in the battlefield fighting, would the mushrikeen ever reach the tent of Rasulullah? Would they dare reach the tent of Rasulullah when you have Ali ibn Abi Talib in the battlefield? Where's the courage in this? When you have Ali ibn Abi Talib, when you know that Ali ibn Abi Talib is in the forefront of the battle, which mushrik would dare reach the tent of Rasulullah? So to guard the tent of Rasulullah, this is a merit? This is courage? This is bravery? I don't know. Al-Jahidh, a well-known Sunni scholar, in his book, Khulasat Kitab al-Uthmaniyya, he makes excuses. Why didn't Abu Bakr participate in the battles? He says, Abu Bakr was like Rasulullah. He was on the same status and level of Rasulullah. Rasulullah was a leader. He would not enter the battle. Just like leaders, you know, kings, emperors, they don't enter into battles. They stand outside the battle. They encourage others to fight, but they don't fight themselves. This is one. Two, just like Rasulullah wouldn't enter battles because he might be killed. Abu Bakr would also be killed. Thus, out of protection, he stayed out of the battle. The answer. Who told you that Rasulullah did not enter the battle? Rasulullah would enter the battlefield just like any other soldier. You think that Rasulullah would stand outside the battlefield and watch his followers fall and fight and get wounded and get injured while he sat and watched? Rasulullah would fight just like any other soldier. In fact, in this verse, regarding the battle of Hunain, إِذْ تُصْعِدُونَ وَلَا تَلْوُونَ عَلَىٰ أَحَدٍ وَالرَّسُولُ يَدْعُوكُمْ فِي أُخْرَاكُمْ. In the battle of Hunain, the companions, they fled, they ran away. And Rasulullah is in the middle of the battlefield. He's calling them, come back. Rasulullah is behind them. They ran, and Rasulullah is behind them. Meaning where? He's in the battlefield. You're telling me Rasulullah did not fight? Rasulullah was in the front. He would always fight in the front lines in the battles. Imam Ali alayhi salam says that at times of difficulty at war, when things got really heated in the battle, we would come and stand behind Rasulullah. Rasulullah would protect us. We wouldn't protect him. He would protect us. Rasulullah would carry his sword and enter the battlefield. You tell me that Rasulullah did not fight and Abu Bakr was like Rasulullah, he shouldn't fight? Rasulullah would fight. Number two, Rasulullah is the leader. Even if, let's say he didn't fight, Rasulullah is the leader. If he didn't fight, because people wanted to kill him, his life was in danger. Who wanted to kill Abu Bakr? Who wanted to kill Abu Bakr? No one wanted to kill Abu Bakr. Even Hind, the mother of Muawiyah, at the Battle of Uhud, when she told Wahshi, she gave Wahshi three options: to kill Ali ibn Abi Talib, or Rasulullah, or whom? Hamza. He couldn't kill Rasulullah. He couldn't kill Ali ibn Abi Talib. He killed Hamza. Did she mention the name of Abu Bakr? Who wanted to kill Abu Bakr in these battles? No one. So these are silly excuses. These are silly excuses. As for the Battle of Khaybar, in the Battle of Khaybar, At-Tabarani, well-known Sunni scholar, in his Majma' al-Zawa'id, Al-Qadhi al-Iji in his book Al-Mawaqif, they mentioned that in the Battle of Khaybar, on the first day, Rasulullah gave the banner to Abu Bakr. He told him to enter the battlefield. Abu Bakr went in, came back, يُجَبِّنُ أَصْحَابَهُ وَيُجَبِّنُوهُ, meaning he calls them cowards and they call him a coward. He tells them, you're cowards. They tell him, you're a coward. Not we're cowards, you're a coward. This is in Sunni sources. And then the next day, Rasulullah said to Umar, Umar couldn't do anything. Same thing, يُجَبِّنُ أَصْحَابَهُ وَيُجَبِّنُوهُ. He calls them cowards, they call him a coward. Finally, Rasulullah at night, he told them, لَأُعْطَيَنَّ الرَّايَةَ غَدًا رَجُلًا, I will give this banner to a man. To a man. Now what does this mean to you? I'll let you analyze and interpret. This is in Bukhari. This is in Muslim. This is in Musnad Ahmad ibn Hanbal. They mentioned this exact quote that Rasulullah said, I will give the banner to a man. لَأُعْطَيَنَّ الرَّايَةَ غَدًا لِرَجُلٍ يُحِبُّ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ, He loves Allah and His Messenger. وَيُحِبُّهُ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ, and Allah and His Messenger also love him. They also love him. يَفْتَحُ اللَّهُ عَلَى يَدَيْهِ لَيْسَ بِفَرَّارٍ, and Allah will bring victory on his hand. The next day he called Ali ibn Abi Talib. صلى على محمد وعلى محمد. So when we examine his courage, and we're trying to be objective here. When we examine the courage of Abu Bakr, when we look at Badr, the Battle of Badr, there's nothing. In the Battle of Uhud, he ran away with all the other Sahaba, and this all historians agree upon, that all the Sahaba ran away in the Battle of Badr except five. One of them was a female. One of them was a female. And there were four men, one of them was Ali ibn Abi Talib. The rest, they all ran away. In the Battle of Khandaq, he had no role. In the Battle of Khaybar, we saw, يُجَبِّنُ أَصْحَابَ وَيُجَبِّنُ, he came back without victory. They call him a coward, and they called him a coward. In the Battle of Hunayn, he ran away with the rest of the companions. So where's the courage? Where's the bravery? Surat Bara'ah. When Surat Bara'ah was revealed, that year, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi had sent Abu Bakr to be Amir al-Hajj, to be the leader of Hajj that year. We accept this. This is a historic fact that Rasulullah sent Abu Bakr to be Amir al-Hajj, to be the leader of the Muslims at Hajj. Then Surah al-Bara'ah was revealed. Surah al-Bara'ah, or Surah Tawbah, it shows the new relationship between the Muslims and the Kuffar. After the conquest of Mecca, now Muslims controlled Mecca. It was no longer in the hands of Quraysh. It was no longer in the hands of the polytheists and the pagans. It was in the hands of Muslims. Now they have the upper hand. Allah dictated new rules to the mushrikeen. One of them, for example, that mushrikeen can no longer enter Mecca. To enter Mecca, you have to be a Muslim. Two, to pray, to perform tawaf. Previously, the Arab, they would perform tawaf nude. They wouldn't wear anything. Now, they have to wear clothing and other rules. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi sent Ali ibn Abi Talib with Surah Bara'ah and the message to Mecca to deliver the message on the day of Arafah. On the day of Arafah, at Arafah in Mecca, in front of all the Muslims, for Ali ibn Abi Talib to deliver the message. And in Sirat ibn Ishaq and Sirat ibn Hisham, these two well-known historians, the best historians on the life of Rasulullah, Ibn Ishaq and Ibn Hisham, they narrate that some people told Rasulullah, why don't you tell Abu Bakr to deliver the message? Now that he's Amir al-Hajj, he's the leader of Hajj, let him deliver the message. He said, no. لا يؤدي عني إلا رجل من أهل بيتي. No one can deliver the message unless it's someone from my family. From my family has to deliver the message. This is in Sirat ibn Ishaq and Sirat ibn Hisham. What does this tell you? If he was not capable of delivering a message to the kuffar, instead, Rasulullah sent Ali ibn Abi Talib. If he was not capable of sending a message, delivering a message, he's capable of leadership, the khilafah. Let's analyze these. You know, when I see Sunni historians, they mention these facts, they mention them without analysis, without contemplation, without thinking over these facts, these historical facts. That why did Rasulullah refuse to send him with Surah Al-Bara'ah? Instead, he sent Ali ibn Abi Talib. Why? Because he was biased towards his cousin, or because he felt that one of them is not capable and the other is capable? If you're not capable of delivering the message of Bara'ah, are you capable of ruling after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Isn't this a sign? During the last days of the Prophet's life, Rasulullah ordered his companions to join the army of Usama ibn Zayd. He ordered the top Sahaba to join the army of Usama ibn Zayd. And amongst those top Sahaba were Abu Bakr and Umar. Read al-Bukhari, Muslim, Ibn Majah, and others, well-known Sunni sources. They will mention that Abu Bakr and Umar were ordered to join that army, the army of Usama ibn Zayd. They refused. They didn't join the army. Rasulullah came out. Why haven't you joined the army of Usama? Again, they did not join. Jahizu Jaysha Usama. Set out the army of Usama. Again, it was neglected. To the point that Rasulullah came out to his mosque and he wasn't feeling well. This has been mentioned in Sharh al-Mawaqif and Al-Milal wal-Nihal by Ash-Sharistani. These are all Sunni sources. These are all Sunni sources. He came out and he said, لَعَنَ اللَّهُ مَنْ تَخَلَّفَ عَنْ جَيْشَ أُسَامَ. May Allah curse those who do not join the army of Usama. This is in Al-Milal wal-Nihal by Sharistani. This is in Sharh al-Mawaqif, two well-known Sunni sources. Yes, you will not find this in Bukhari. You will not find this in Muslim. Why? Because Rasulullah is cursing those that do not join the army of Usama. So obviously, some authors will not put this in their books. Al-Bukhari will not put this. Muslim will not put this. But Al-Shahristani in Al-Milal wal-Nihal, he put it. Sharh al-Mawaqif, he put it in his book. That Rasulullah cursed those that did not join the army of Osama bin Zayd. You be the judge. Among the merits that have been mentioned for Abu Bakr that our Sunni brothers and sisters have mentioned is that on the final day of Rasulullah's life, Rasulullah ordered Abu Bakr to lead the salah, to lead the morning prayer. They say this is a merit, this is a virtue for Abu Bakr. And since he ordered him to pray, to lead jama'ah, and he did not remove him, that means he should continue leading the jama'ah after his death. And whoever is most qualified to lead the jama'ah is more qualified to lead the Muslim ummah, right? So they say this is one of the biggest proof for the imam, for the leadership of Abu Bakr. Last year during Muharram, exactly during these nights, I gave a lecture on this topic. Did Abu Bakr lead the salah? For those of you that are interested tonight, when you go back home, look it up on YouTube. Did Abu Bakr lead the salah? And I talked about it. I will give you a brief summary. I don't want you to get into the details. I reached the following conclusion. That we cannot accept those narrations. There's numerous narrations that Abu Bakr led the salah. We cannot accept them. Why? Number one, they contradict one another. One narration says that Rasulullah got up And he came and he stood behind Abu Bakr. He prayed behind Abu Bakr. Another narration says that he stood next to him. Another narration says that he stood in front of him. Well, which one of them is correct? We don't know. They contradict. Two, why did Rasulullah drag himself out of his house when he heard the voice of Abu Bakr praying? He dragged himself out with the help of Ibn Abbas and Imam Ali. They carried him and he came to the masjid. Why? If he had ordered Abu Bakr to pray, why did he do so? Why did he drag himself and come and pray? Number three, why did Rasulullah scold his wives, Aisha and Hafsa? And he say, إِنَّكُنَّ لَصَوَيْحِبَاتِ يُوسِفِ. Why did he scold his wives? Go listen to that lecture. I mentioned the reasons why from Sunni sources. Number four, Rasulullah had ordered Abu Bakr to join the army of Osama bin Zayd. How can he order him to lead Salah? Does Rasulullah contradict himself? He ordered him to join the army of Osama bin Zayd. He should leave the city. Why would he order him to lead Salah? That would be a contradiction. Five, as an analysis, we reached the conclusion from those narrations that it was not Rasulullah that told Abu Bakr to lead the Salah. It was whom? It was his daughter Aisha. Number six, even if, let's say, that Rasulullah had ordered Abu Bakr to lead the Salah, so what? So what? Rasulullah, when he would leave Medina, he would ask Ibn Umm Maktum, the blind man, who we'll talk about in a couple of nights, inshallah. He would order him to lead Salah. How come no one says that Ibn Umm Maktum should be the Imam and should be the Khalifa of Rasulullah? No one says it. Didn't Rasulullah order him to pray? So if Rasulullah ordered Abu Bakr to pray, so what? He would order others to pray. Number six or number seven, I don't know. According to our Sunni brothers and sisters, that anyone could lead Salah. Anyone could lead Salah. That is why I'm sure you see them at college, at university, at airports, wherever. Whoever is leading Salah, they come and stand behind him and they pray. There's no criteria for the Imam of the Salah. Even if he's an alcoholic, even if he drinks and fornicates, you can still pray behind him. This is in the Sunni fiqh. They accept this. They say, صَلُّوا خَلْفْ كُلِّ بِرٍّ وَفَاجِرٍ. This is in their fiqh. So what is it, a merit? Let's say, hypothetically speaking, that Rasulullah had told Abu Bakr to pray. That doesn't prove anything. That doesn't prove any sort of virtue. صلى الله على محمد وعلى محمد. Rasulullah passed away. Abu Bakr came to the Khilafah. How did he come? Did Rasulullah appoint him? Did Rasulullah hold his hand at Ghadir Khum and say, Man kuntu mawlah fahada Aba Bakr mawlah? In which hadith, in which instant, in which incident, in which event did Rasulullah appoint Abu Bakr? None. And I don't think our brothers and sisters could tell us any event in which Rasulullah explicitly appoints Abu Bakr as the Khalifa after him. They all agree that Abu Bakr came to power through Saqifa. At Saqifa, Abu Bakr and Umar heard that the Ansar had gathered at Saqifa to Bani Sa'da, and they're about to appoint a Khalifa, an Imam from them. Abu Bakr and Umar rushed to the scene. And I have a lecture on this as well, called An Analysis of Saqifa. It's on YouTube. I can't get into a lot of details because I'm restricted on time. If you want more details, listen to that lecture and an analysis of Saqifa. It's on YouTube. They rush to the scene. And they're saying that Rasulullah had died. Umar stands and says, who says that Rasulullah had died? He took out his sword and he said, I will strike with my sword the one that says that Rasulullah has died. This is in all Sunni sources. Al-Imam al-Siyasa, Ibn Qutaybah, and others. In Al-Tabari, he mentions this, that Umar began making threats. Do not say that Rasulullah died. And then Abu Bakr came and he calmed things down. Of course, they played this role. Umar would be the rough one, the aggressive, and Abu Bakr was the diplomatic politician. He came and he said, no, Umar, calm down. Rasulullah has died. Indeed, he has died. And then he said that whoever of you worshipped Rasulullah, if you worshipped Muhammad, Muhammad is dead. But if you worshipped Allah, Allah is alive. And then he recited this verse. وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلُ أَفَإِنْ مَاتَ أَوْ قُتِلَ إِنْقَلَبْتُمْ عَلَىٰ عَقَابِكُمْ. He recited this verse. They came and they took control of the situation. Then Abu Bakr, he points to Umar and Abi Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah, a well-known Sahabi of Rasulullah. This is in all Sunni narrations. In Sunni sources, namely in Imam al-Imama wa-Siyasa by Ibn Qutaybah, he says, لَقَدْ رَضِيتُ لَكُمْ أَحَدُ هَذَيْنِ الرَّجُلَيْنِ. I have accepted for you one of these two men to be the Imam, Abu Bakr and Ubaidah, Abi Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah. It's as if someone had asked for his opinion. I accept for you. لَقَدْ رَضِيتُ لَكُمْ أَحَدُ هَذِينَ. Who asked for your opinion? He tells them, I've chosen for you, I have accepted for you one of these two men. It was here that Umar ibn al-Khattab extended his hand to Abu Bakr. He gave him his bay'ah. Abu Bakr gives him his hand and he gives him his bay'ah. And then one by one they came and gave their bay'ah to Abu Bakr. Was this an appointment by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Is there a verse? Is there a hadith? Is there a narration? What is there? They all agree that it was, the appointment came from Umar ibn al-Khattab. Umar ibn al-Khattab gave his allegiance to Abu Bakr and the rest followed, whether willingly or unwillingly. How many people came to give their allegiance? That's another story. But the first to give his allegiance was Abu Bakr. This is the story of his appointment. Now the biggest proof that this was done in an unjust way, this was done in a way that does not please Allah nor the Messenger of Allah, the biggest proof that Abu Bakr usurped the Khilafah is Abu Bakr himself and Umar. Now listen to this. Umar ibn al-Khattab, in Sirat ibn Hisham, the most prominent, the most well-known biography of Rasulullah by a Sunni historian, Ibn Hisham, he narrates by Umar. Umar was asked that, what do you think of the bay'ah of Abu Bakr? This was many years later, of course. Many years later. What do you think of the bay'ah of Abu Bakr? Wasn't it a mistake? He said, yes, indeed, it was a mistake. فَلَا يَغُرَّنَّ امْرِئٌ أَنْ يَقُولْ إِنَّ بَيْعَةَ أَبِي بَكْرِ كَانَتْ فَلْتَةً فَتَمَّتْ وَأَنَّهَا قَدْ كَانَتْ كَذَلِكَ إِلَّا أَنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ وَقَى شَرَّهَا. I don't want to hear anyone to say that the bay'ah, the allegiance of Abu Bakr was a mistake. Indeed, it was a mistake. It was فَلْتَة. فَلْتَة is a mistake that you get away with. You know, when you pass a red light, and no one sees you, a police officer didn't see you, that's called a falta. He says the allegiance of Abu Bakr was a falta, it was a mistake, but we got away with it. However, waqallah sharraha, Allah passed its evil. Allah made sure that there is no evil that came from this allegiance. These are the words of Umar ibn Khattab in Sirat ibn Hisham. Abu Bakr himself, after the day of Saqifa, he was recorded saying, أما بعد أيها الناس فإني قد وليت عليكم ولست بخيركم. Oh people, I became your leader and I am not the best among you. Really? I became your leader and I am not the best among you. This is in الطبقات لابن سعد, الإمامة والسياسة لابن قتيبة, تاريخ الطبري, سيرة ابن هشام. And then he continues, أما والله ما أنا بخيركم. By God, I am not the best among you. ولقد كنت لمقامي هذا كارها. And I hated being your leader. I did not want to be your leader. ولوددت أن فيكم من يكفيني. And I wish there was someone else besides me who would came to be the leader. These are his own words. And in the same speech, he says, وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ لِي شَيْطَانًا يَعْتَرِينِي. And know that I have a shaytan that comes to me. I have a shaytan, يَعْتَرِينِي, that comes and deceives me. These are in the following sources.
طبقات ابن سعد الإمام والسياسة تاريخ الطبري سيرة ابن هشام. These are not in Shia sources. These are not in Shia sources. Come and ask me after the lecture. I'll be more than happy to show you these sources, Sunni sources. He also had stated, وَوَدَدْتُ عَنِّي يَوْمَ السَّقِيفَةِ أَنَّ يَوْمَ السَّقِيفَةِ بَنِي سَاعَدَةِ كُنْتُ قَذَفْتُ الْأَمْرَ فِي عُنُقْ أَحَدُ الرَّجُلَيْنِ. Many years later, or towards, well, 2 years later, probably before his death, he stated that I wish on the day of Saqifa I had not taken this leadership. And I had given it to one of the two men. Which ones? Umar and Abi Ubaidah ibn Jarrah. فَكَانَ أَحَدُهُمَا أَمِيرًا وَكُنْتُ وَزِيرًا. One of them would have been the Amir and I would have been his helper. And then he says, وَوَدَدْتُ أَنِّي سَأَلْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ لِمَنْ هَذَا الْأَمْرِ فَلَا يَنَازُ أَحَدٍ. And I wish I had asked Rasulullah, who is your Khalifa after you? Now you remember? Now after you became the Khalifa, now you remember that I wish I had asked Rasulullah? This is in Tariqh al-Tabari, al-Imam wa-Siyasa, wa al-Murawwij al-Dhahab lil-Mas'udi. As for Abu Bakr and Fatima al-Zahra, everyone knows their relationship. For Abu Bakr, 10 days after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, he took the land of Fadak from Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salam. Everyone knows the story of Fadak. I don't wish to go into details. Fadak was given to Fatima al-Zahra by Rasulullah as a gift. It was a gift to Fatima al-Zahra. She came and told Abu Bakr that this was a gift. He said, "Who? Do you have any witnesses?" She said, "Yes, Ali ibn Abi Talib." He said, "He's your husband. He's biased." Umm Ayman. He said, "She's a lady." Al-Hasan wal-Husayn. He said, "They're kids. I can't accept their witnesses. I can't accept their testimonies." She said, "Okay. Inheritance. It's not a gift. It's my inheritance. My father died. It belonged to Rasulullah and it's my inheritance." He said, "No. Because I heard Rasulullah say, نحن معاشر الأنبياء لا نورث ما تركناه صدقة. We the prophets, we do not leave inheritance. Whatever we leave behind is what? Charity, صدقة. Subhanallah. The Quran says, وَوَرِثَ سُلَيْمَانُ دَاوُودِ. Sulaiman inherited Dawood. Zakariya says, فَهَبْلِي مِن لَدُنْكَ وَلِيَّا يَرِثُنِي. Grant me an heir. Zakariya was a prophet. Grant me an heir. Someone to receive my inheritance. And subhanAllah, no one else had heard this hadith other than Abu Bakr. نحن معاشر الأنبياء لا نورث ما تركناه صدق. No one else had heard this hadith other than Abu Bakr. What does this tell you? Al-Bukhari in his Sahih narrates the following. He narrates that Rasulullah had stated, إن الله يرضى لرضى فاطمة ويغضب لغضبها. That Allah is angered for the anger of Fatima, and He is pleased for the satisfaction of Fatima. This is in Bukhari, and Bukhari himself states, وجدت فاطمة على أبي بكر في ذلك فهجرته فلم تزل مهاجرته حتى توفيت. Fatima al-Zahra was dissatisfied with Abu Bakr. She was not pleased. She was upset at Abu Bakr. Bukhari himself narrates that Allah is pleased to the pleasure of Fatima, and he is dissatisfied to the dissatisfaction of Fatima. And he himself narrates that Fatima was upset at Abu Bakr. She was upset at Abu Bakr. This is in Bukhari. Until the day that she died. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Ibn Hisham, Sirat Ibn Hisham, the famous historian in his book, he says that a man came to Abu Bakr before the Prophet's death. He told him, "Give me advice. Give me advice." This man by the name of Rafi' ibn Abi Umairah, he told him, "Give me advice." Abu Bakr gave him several advice. Among the advice, the last piece of advice, he told him, "And never be the leader of anyone. Never be the leader of anyone. Even if it's one person, do not be his leader. Avoid leadership." Rasulullah dies, and who becomes the Khalifa? Abu Bakr. The same man comes to Abu Bakr, Rafi. He told him, "Ya Abu Bakr, remember the advice that you gave me? That do not be the leader of anyone, even if it's one person. What do I see you today? Today you became the leader. You gave me advice and you did not practice what you preached?" Abu Bakr, and this is in Sirat ibn Hisham, told him, "Yes, I had to. I had no other option." You had no other option? You have Ali ibn Abi Talib. You have so many other Sahaba. There were so many others. You had no other option? He said, "I feared for the nation of Rasulullah. I feared for the division of the nation of Rasulullah. So I became the leader." Subhanallah. Now when Abu Bakr came to power and he became Khalifa, one of the prominent features about the days of Abu Bakr were the Ridda Wars. The Ridda Wars. The wars of apostasy. They mention, historians mention, that many people after the death of Rasulullah became apostates. They abandoned Islam and they declared war. And hence Abu Bakr had to fight these people. They had to fight the people that were formerly Muslims but were no longer Muslims. In reality, these people that are so-called apostates, they had denied to give their zakat to Abu Bakr. They had denied to give their zakat. When was this a crime, to not give your zakat? When was not giving zakat a crime punishable? You deserve death for not giving zakat. When was this? Did Rasulullah ever kill someone for not giving zakat? Or for denying giving zakat? Where? Where did we see this in Islamic history? Just because you don't give your zakat. In reality, many of these Sahaba who refused to give their zakat, you know why they didn't give their zakat? Because they wanted to give their zakat to the rightful Imam. They wanted to give their zakat to the rightful Khalifa. When they saw that the rightful Khalifa did not come to power, because just less than 2 months before the death of the Prophet, they had seen with their own eyes that Rasulullah stood at Ghadir Khum and appointed someone else, Ali ibn Abi Talib. Now someone else had come to power. Obviously they're not going to give their zakat. They're not going to give their zakat. Hence they were fought. And many of them were killed in the name of Ridda. In the name of apostasy. They had abandoned Islam. Now one of these innocent men, his name was Malik ibn Nuwayra. Malik ibn Nuwayra was an innocent man. One of the companions of Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam. He had refused to give his zakat to Abu Bakr. Abu Bakr sends Khalid ibn al-Walid. He tells him, "Go and get the zakat of Malik ibn Nuwayra." Khalid ibn al-Walid comes to Malik ibn Nuwayra. He asks him for the zakat. He tells him, "I will not give my zakat to Abu Bakr because I do not acknowledge Abu Bakr as my imam, as my khalifa." He tells him, "Okay, but I will have to kill you." "Kill me? Kill me for what? For denying zakat?" He said, "Yes." But there was something else to it. What was the problem? Malik ibn Nuwayra had a very beautiful wife. And Khalid knew about this. Khalid knew that Malik ibn Nuwayra had a beautiful wife. In fact, he had seen her. She was known as the most beautiful woman among the Arab. When Khalid ibn al-Walid was about to kill Malik ibn Nuwayra, Malik's wife came out of the tent. Khalid saw her. Malik looked at his wife and he said, "You killed me." He told his wife, "You killed me." Meaning what? Of course she didn't kill him. Meaning, "I am dying because of you. He's killing me because of you." Khalid ibn al-Walid killed Malik ibn Nuwayra, this pious, righteous man. And then he took his head, he chopped off his head. He cut off his head, he put it on fire like wood, and he put a pot on top of his head, on the head of Malik ibn Nuwayra. Who does this remind you of? The actions of whom? ISIS? If you're wondering where ISIS learned their barbarism from, their aggression from, you don't have to look too far. It's from these men. It's from these men in history. News reached Abu Bakr that your man, Khalid ibn al-Walid, this is what he did. By the way, Khalid ibn al-Walid, he killed Malik ibn Nuwayra, and that same night, he had a a relationship with his wife. He had an illegitimate relationship with his wife. News reaches Abu Bakr. Omar was extremely upset. He came to Abu Bakr shouting and yelling that you have to punish Khalid ibn al-Walid. Abu Bakr said, no, I will not punish him. And he said this, Ya Umar, ta'awwala fa akhta. Ya Umar, Khalid is a mujtahid. He made a decision, yet he made a mistake. فارفع لسانك عن خالد. Do not speak ill of Khalid. فإني لا أشيم سيفا سله الله على الكافرين. I will not take the sword of Khalid, the sword that Allah has set it out on the mushrikeen. He defends Khalid ibn al-Walid. Abu Bakr outright defends Khalid ibn al-Walid. Now let's come to his personal merits. Let's come to his knowledge and his narrations. How many narrations did Abu Bakr have? How many narrations do you think Abu Bakr had? As-Suyuti, Al-Hafidh Jalaluddin As-Suyuti, in his book Al-Itqan, he says that out of the four Khulafa, Ali ibn Abi Talib had the most narrations. The other three have very few narrations, especially Abu Bakr. And he makes a justification, and he makes an excuse. He says, because he didn't live long. And the only ahadith that I memorize of Abu Bakr, only 10. Al-Hafidh al-Suyuti, he says only 10. Ahmed ibn Hanbal, in his famous book Al-Musnad, in which he narrates 750,000 narrations, only 82 of them are from Abu Bakr. Or 80 of them are from Abu Bakr. 20 of them are repetitive. That means how many of them are? There's only 60. In Musnad Ahmed ibn Hanbal, Abu Bakr only has 60 narrations. The Sahabi of Rasulullah that lived so many years with Rasulullah, he only mentioned 60 narrations from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ibn al-Kathir wrote a book called Musnad al-Siddiq. He gathered all of the narrations of Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, and he mentions only 72 narrations only. That's the only narrations that he had. As for his knowledge, the knowledge of Abu Bakr, during the days of Abu Bakr, a thief was brought in his presence. One of his hands were already cut off because he was a thief. He had stolen before. So they came to Abu Bakr and they asked him, what should we do? Abu Bakr looked at him and he said, you know, he lost one hand. He only has one. Poor guy. Don't cut off his hand. Cut off his feet. The Quran says, As-sariqu was-sariqa faqta'u aydihima. Cut off his hands. He said, cut off his feet. This is an As-Sunan al-Bayhaqi, Sunni source. Al-Bayhaqi is a Sunni in his famous book, Sunan al-Bayhaqi. Umar corrected Abu Bakr. He told him, what are you doing? The Quran says, cut off the hand of a thief, not cut off his leg or his foot. Many things have been mentioned about his knowledge. I don't have time. We're running out of time. I will not mention the others. What about his worship? Did he have special worship? Any special supplications? Any special salah? Nothing is mentioned about his worship. In fact, in the book Kitab Umdatu al-Tahqiq lil-Ubaydi al-Maliki, Umar ibn al-Khattab asked Aisha, the daughter of Abu Bakr. Obviously, she should know him the best. She's his daughter. He told her, tell me about your father. What would he do when he would come back home at night? Tell me about him at home, at night. What would he do? She told him, ما رأينا له كثير صلاة بالليل ولا قيام. We never saw Abu Bakr praying at night, صلاة الليل, صلاة التهجد. No, nothing of that sort. He had no special merits or virtues when it came to worship at night, any supplications. Yes, he had one merit, and that he would sit and he would think deeply. And he would sigh, and then smoke would come out of his mouth. Why? Because his liver would be on fire. It would set on fire. His liver would be barbecued. This is in Sunni sources. They mention this as a merit and virtue for Abu Bakr, that his liver would be barbecued because of his worries, of his sadness. I wonder what he was sad about. Was it the attack on the house of Fatima al-Zahra? Or the taking of the Khilafah of Ali ibn Abi Talib, or the abortion of Muhsin, the fetus of Fatima Tazara. Well, these are Shia sources, and we said we'll avoid Shia sources tonight. Let's stick to the Sunni sources. عن أبي بكر ابن عبد الله المزني, a narrator, an author, he says, لم يفضل أبو بكر الناس بكثرة صوم ولا صلاة, إنما فضلهم شيء كان في قلبه. Abu Bakr did not have special merits, any special fasting, he would fast a lot or pray a lot or worship a lot. No, it was something in his heart, he had special sadness. Now how about his akhlaq and his manners? As briefly, what were some of his manners? Al-Bukhari tells us some of his manners. Al-Bukhari tells us that one day a clan from Bani Tamim came to visit Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Abu Bakr and Umar, they were both there. Abu Bakr chose one of them to lead the delegation. Umar chose another one to lead the delegation. They got in an argument. Each one wanted someone else to lead the delegation. Abu Bakr started shouting at Umar that you're only trying to disobey me. Umar told him, no, you're the one that is trying to disobey me. They started shouting in the presence of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Hence, the verse was revealed, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَرْفَعُوا أَصْوَاتَكُمْ فَوْقَ صَوْتِ النَّبِيِّ. All you who believe, do not raise your voice over the voice of the Prophet and the presence of the Prophet. This verse was revealed regarding Abu Bakr and Umar and Al-Bukhari. And this is very strange. Al-Bukhari usually doesn't say things like this, but he said it here. He said, كَادَ الْخَيِّرَانِ أَنْ يَهْلَكَ أَبُو بَكْرُ وَعُمَرُ رَفَعَ أَصْوَاتُهُمَا عِنْدَ النَّبِيِّ. The two righteous men, Abu Bakr and Umar, were about to perish because they raised their voice in the presence of Rasulullah. This is the manners. These are the manners and akhlaq of Abu Bakr. In another narration, in a Sunni source, Ibn Asakir, in his famous book Tariq Dimashq, the history of Dimashq, he says that Abu Bakr and Aqil, the uncle of Rasulullah, they started swearing at each other, using foul language, swearing at each other. استب عقيل ابن أبي طالب وأبو بكر وكان أبو بكر سبابا. Abu Bakr was sabab. What does sabab mean? Means he would always use foul language. This was one of his qualities. He would always use foul language. This is in Ibn Asakir fi Tariq Dimashq. Go and look it up. You will see this. In Al-Khasa'is Al-Kubra, he says that this event that Abu Bakr and Aqil, they would curse one another, use foul language with one another, this was in the presence of Rasulullah. Rasulullah saw them, heard them. And among his manners and akhlaq, in Sunni sources, was that he would drink wine. Now historians here, they disagree. Was this before the forbiddance of alcohol or after? Because in Islam, alcohol was not forbidden from the first day. It was forbidden later on. So when Abu Bakr drank wine, was it before it was forbidden or after? They disagree. But they all agree that he did drink wine even after converting to Islam. Ibn Hajar, in his book Al-Isaba, he says, شرب اعتمد نفطوي على هذه الرواية فقال شرب أبو بكر الخمر قبل أن تحرم. He said that Abu Bakr drank wine before it was forbidden. Before it was forbidden. Abu Bakr died on the 23rd of Jamad al-Ula, on the year 13 after Hijrah. When he died, Umar prayed on his body. How did he die? And I conclude with this. How did he die? Did he die a natural death? Or was he assassinated? Was he poisoned? Most historians say that he died a natural death. However, Ibn al-Athir and Ustu al-Ghaba mentions that Umar ibn al-Khattab was poisoned. Abu Bakr and Al-Harith ibn Kalda were eating food together. All of a sudden, Al-Harith felt that this food is poisoned. So he told Abu Bakr, stop eating. They both stopped eating. He told them, I know this poison. This poison will kill us in exactly 1 year. You and me will die exactly in a year from now. And then he says, they died, him, Abu Bakr and Al-Harith ibn Kalda died on the same exact day. Abu Bakr was poisoned. But by whom? Now, Sunni historians don't say this. They don't even emphasize that Abu Bakr was killed or poisoned. They usually say that he died. They never say that he was poisoned. Why? Because this raises questions. Who killed Abu Bakr? Who poisoned him? Who had interests in getting rid of Abu Bakr? Who? Who came after him? Who benefited the most from his death? Let's analyze and let's think. And I'll let you take this home with you and analyze this and think about this. If Abu Bakr was killed and poisoned, who most likely killed him and poisoned him? Who benefited from his death?